My name is Bruce Cole. I'm not an immigrant from Rothschild. She was unable to make it to the unveiling meeting, so I'm filling in for her. The name of this session is The Economics of Radical Uncertainty. We have three different speakers, Angus Bergen, Paul Pomerod, and Eric Weinstein. We'll take them in that order, and then we'll have time for questions at the end. There are going to be microphones posted in the center aisle at the end, so if you do have a question, you'll need to get out of the sheet and come up to the microphone. Okay, so let's go ahead and get started then. The first speaker is Angus Bergen, Department of History, Johns Hopkins.
So between Robert Johnson's remarks yesterday on the panel, in the panel on uncertainty and reflexivity this morning, the name Frank Knight has been very prominent in our discussions over the past 2 days. We've repeatedly invoked his distinction between risk and uncertainty as a way of helping to lay the groundwork for some of our discussions about the unknowable nature of the future in the present. But whereas most invocations of Knight begin and end with the observation of that distinction alone, what I'd like to do today is to revisit the broader argument of risk, uncertainty, and profit, to think with Knight about the nature of uncertainty and some of the distinct problems it poses, some of what we might learn from it today. Knight, as some of you might know, began his graduate training at Cornell in the philosophy department. He only left philosophy when he was declared by his advisor too skeptical for the discipline. And his treatment of uncertainty situated it in a deep social and philosophical context that more technical discussions of the distinction too often eschew. So in the following remarks, what I'm going to try to do is pull out five ideas from Knight that maybe we can think with a little bit as we parse through contemporary debates about uncertainty. First, Knight's argument in that book that uncertainty is everywhere, that it's a fundamental and inextricable aspect of the human condition. Second, that our response to uncertainty is deeply conflicted. Third, that it plays a foundational role in the development of political ideologies, that we need to think about uncertainty when we think about problems of politics. Fourth, that it's an important variable when we try to understand historical changes in economic and political views. And fifth, these aspects of uncertainty can only be understood through literary or fully understood when we are willing to adopt literary methodologies that eschew the temptation to quantify. So all this will suggest that Knight's economics of radical uncertainty would look quite different from those that have predominated in recent years, and that some of the problems that he emphasizes might help both historians and economists to reframe their approach to the problem in productive ways. Okay, so first, Knight's observation that uncertainty was everywhere. I just want to pull out the fact that Knight was very explicit about this. In his words, it's a world of change in which we live, and a world of uncertainty. We live only by knowing something about the future, while the problems of life or of conduct at least arise from the fact that we know so little. Right? So I think in David Tuckett's paper that he gave last year, which I think Paul will be building a little bit on, as I understand it, this is what we define as ontological uncertainty, right? The deep unknowability, the fundamental unknowability of the future. Knight begins with this sense of epistemic humility. For him, quantitative tools are merely bulwarks against a bafflingly complex, in his words, and fundamentally unknowable future. Therefore, when we plan for the future course of events, as he says, opinions and not scientific knowledge actually guide most of our conduct. Whereas later economists sought to bracket irreducible uncertainty, for Knight it's a constant and fundamental aspect of the human condition. And he held that any suggestion otherwise would be misguided and deceiving. Okay, so second, Knight emphasized that our responses to uncertainty were necessarily and irresolvably conflicted. In some some literature, there's a tendency to suggest that uncertainty should be minimized, right? That it's a good idea, for instance, philosophical literature on block minimization. Whereas others celebrate it as the great engine of capitalist growth. But Knight suggested that either emphasis to the exclusion of the other would be myopic. So on the one hand, uncertainty is inherently terrifying. Over an extended period, too much of it would be unsustainable for any person or polity. On the other hand, so in Knight's terms, it goes without saying that rational conduct strives to reduce to a minimum the uncertainties involved in an academic institution. On the other hand, uncertainty is what makes life interesting. It's what creates space for the intellect. It's what makes profit itself possible. In his words, and I think this is really crucial for understanding Knight, with uncertainty absent, man's energies are devoted altogether to doing things. It is doubtful whether intelligence itself would exist in such a situation. In a world so built that perfect knowledge was theoretically possible, it seems likely that all organic readjustments would become mechanical, all organisms automata. So our approach to uncertainty is inherently paradoxical, and at a certain point resists logical reduction. As he observes at the conclusion of the book, the very idea of intelligent conduct implies an effort to reduce uncertainty, while nonetheless we recognize, on any calm, cool contemplation of the matter, that a life with uncertainty eliminated, or perhaps even very greatly reduced, would not appeal to us. So this is a characteristically bleak Knightian formulation, right? We're constantly attempting to constrain precisely that quality that makes our lives worthwhile. Okay, third, Knight sees this uncertainty as forming a substratum for our debates about political economy. When confronted by the unknowability of the future, humans have widely differing responses. Some express a high degree of sensitivity to particular forms of uncertainty, while others are much more willing to embrace and accept uncertainties for the benefits they can potentially afford. So in Knight's view, those who dislike uncertainties will be much more inclined to invest in those activities that limit his reach. Right? So these include the acquisition of knowledge, which Knight emphasized can be a very expensive endeavor, the establishment of large-scale organizations, which he saw as helping to deflect certain kinds of uncertainties, and the imposition of constraints on the pace of economic change, right? Perhaps the biggest one, you impede progress itself in order to make the future more knowable. Whereas those who are less sensitive to uncertainty will view the masses, as he claimed, the costs associated with each of these activities with skepticism. So according to Knight, some seek to sacrifice progress in order to increase the knowability of the future, while others embrace the benefits of change and complexity at the cost of security and the capacity to predict. In other words, political disputes are structured as much by different dispositional tolerances for uncertainty as by ideological or material concerns. So of course, as the debate among Knight's contemporaries who are concerned with these kinds of problems demonstrated, these dispositional tolerances were very complex in practice. Right? So if you take the examples of Hayek and Keynes, both worried deeply about problems of uncertainty, but they reserved their concerns for their primary concerns for uncertainties of a very different kind. So Hayek's emphasis on the ignorance of the individual in essays like Economics and Knowledge. Or many of the commonalities with Knight's discussions of uncertainty, as Bruce Caldwell had in his provocative and essay that I largely agree with in the Journal of Economic Methodology, argues that we can see some commonalities between Hayek and Soros, despite what seem to be very striking differences. But for Hayek, it's crucial to understand that the uncertainties that bothered him most were precisely those uncertainties that are themselves created by the state. Political uncertainties. And therefore, a primary concern becomes the creation of a stable network of laws that will allow business operators to proceed with a minimum of political indeterminacy. Keynes, in contrast, emphasized the crippling experience of uncertainty among everyday people, the capacity of business people to take advantage of these uncertainties to create massive inequalities of wealth, and argue that a host of interventions were necessary to help to limit them. It becomes a still more complex and fraught problem in Joseph Schumpeter's Capitalism, Socialism, and Democracy. So though he's highly sympathetic to Knight's idea of uncertainty, times. He worried that the existence of uncertainty was becoming increasingly marginalized by tendencies within capitalism itself, right? So you got these wonderful ironic lines where he says, innovation itself is being reduced to routine. Technological progress is increasingly becoming the business of teams of trained specialists who turn out what is required and make it work in predictable ways. Market societies, that is, are squeezing out the very uncertainties that are their lifeblood. Since capitalist enterprises, he says, by their very achievements tend to automatize progress, we conclude that they tend to make themselves superfluous. Schumpeter's deep political pessimism emerged from his assessment of the changing structure of social and technological change. His high tolerance for certain kinds of uncertainty was accompanied by skepticism about the sustainability of an economic order that was premised on it. So however distinct their different views, these economists, all like Knight, approached uncertainty as a problem of moral and political philosophy that could not be captured by economic analysis alone. Designing an economic order required foundational decisions about the kinds of uncertainties that can be mitigated and the degree to which it was desirable to do so. For this final generation of literary economists, the intellectual history of the discipline was in part a story of embedded assumptions about the shape of the future and the degree to which it can or should be known. Okay, fourth, and bear with me here, this is just a little bit for the few historians out there. I think by drawing attention to the thick social politics of uncertainty, Knight suggests that it's a crucial variable for us to consider when writing the intellectual history of political ideologies. I think historians are suspicious generally of the concept of uncertainty in part because of its very messiness, right? It's difficult to think about uncertainty, in part because it is in fact everywhere. It manifests itself in so many different ways. In part for that reason, historians in recent years have tended to heavily emphasize the history of risk, the history of probability. So we now frame the period between the late 18th and the early 20th centuries in part as the story of the rise of probabilistic reasoning. In Ian Hacking's powerful formulation, the world itself became numerical, and the imperialism of probabilities was the philosophical success story of the first half of the 20th century. These histories, in turn, have led narratives about risk to become increasingly central to our social, cultural, and intellectual histories of the United States. As Jonathan Levy strikingly suggests in his book, Freaks of Fortune, in the 19th century, risk burrowed into popular consciousness and became an inextricable part of the modern condition. Technological developments created new risks, which in turn were mitigated by corporate and social insurance. So you can see here, as Mariana gestured towards in her comments yesterday, and as was observed in an essay in Dissent magazine, the spring 2014 issue, the return of Carl Polanyi, right, historian of double movement, in which the expansion of risk creates a need for social policies that counteract its excesses. This is once again found a broad and appreciative audience. So for all the insights of this massive new literature, I think the attention to the history of risk and the various kinds of probability that people use to identify and constrain it, precisely the problems of Knightian uncertainty get marginalized. They take on the role of a silence factor behind a broader narrative about the taming of chance. Knight reminds us to think about how to write a history of qualitative engagements with problems of uncertainty, which itself can provide a sensitive barometer of the shifting sensibility people held about the social role of the market. So I think for one example of this kind of history, we can look to our intended moderator Emma Rothschild's book, Economic Sentiments, in its argument that the universe of Enlightenment political economy was one in which uncertainty was everywhere, and politics was in large part a matter of tolerance for its reach. In her analysis, she says, the universe of imaginative uncertainty is also the rise of commerce. So economic ideas are closely related to perspectives on uncertainty, and social policy is constructed in constant dialogue with the unknowability of the future. Historians of later periods might ask the same questions that Rothschild asks of her subjects, even if the responses become cagier and more difficult to discern. However sophisticated the quantitative techniques of our subjects, we would be wise to remember that ideas about political economic systems nonetheless rely on assumptions options of the reach and desirability of the qualitative uncertainties that they produce. All right, fifth and finally, Knight suggests that because uncertainty itself, in his view, and it's controversial, resists quantification and evades rationality, our engagements with it will need to embrace literary and philosophical analysis. So here, I think the famous story about Knight is opposite that when he used to walk by Lord Kelvin's dictum that was inscribed in the social sciences building at the University of Chicago, when you cannot measure, your knowledge is meager and unsatisfactory. He was known to sarcastically mutter, and if you can't measure it anyway. As his own approach to risk, uncertainty, and profit demonstrated, he believed that engagements with the problem of change should approach it at least in part in qualitative terms. Now, of course, with some notable exceptions, Knight's perspective became increasingly marginalized in the economics profession in the later years of his life. The social and philosophical implications of these kinds of uncertainty largely fell to the margins of disciplinary debates. So historians who are interested in the problem, I think, largely need to look elsewhere to try to historicize it, to try to understand where debates about the fixed social and philosophical problems of uncertainty went. And here I think we can look beyond economics departments towards the dynamic interdisciplinary communities that began to cluster around these questions in the post-war era, consisting not coincidentally in an era of disciplinary specialization, largely of people who were themselves marginalized by their own disciplines. Right? So people like Robert Heilbronner, Bertrand de Jouvenel, Alvin Toffler, Daniel Bell, this cluster of people associated with futures research. And similarly, they posed a foundational problematic for Peter Drucker, and as such lie at the point of origin, as I see it, for the 20th century management theory. So just to say a few words about Drucker and to think about how the problem of uncertainty migrates into different disciplines at this time. By the time he wrote The New Society in 49, Drucker had arrived at the conclusion that uncertainty was becoming ever more central to our experience of the economic world. It's characteristic of industrial production, he wrote, that every single increase in efficiency and productivity increases the uncertainty of industrial production. Research grows ever more distant in time and concept from the products that it may or may not yield. By 1957, he was proclaiming that we had entered into a new, as yet nameless era, marked by changes brought on by innovations in the production process. The problems posed by these uncertainties underlay all of his subsequent work, his attempts to systematize innovation as a leap into the unknown, to redress the, in his words, unbearable social and psychological toll exacted by this rapid pace of change, to critique the long odds that confront the projections adopted by any governmental planning regime, and to draw attention to the centrality of knowledge in a world persistently confronted by the absence thereof, as Drucker famously coined the phrase knowledge work. By the 1960s, he was using such phrases as knowledge is the only capital. As the historian Jackson Beers has perceptively observed, strategies of managerial rationality necessarily inhabit this fraught space between chance and the desire for control. And in this sense, the work of Drucker allows us to see the modern discipline of management emerging in large part out of an attempt to theorize precisely the kinds of uncertainty that we're increasingly moving to the margins of the economics profession. So for historians, I think the amorphous and omnipresent uncertainties addressed by Knight provide a counter-narrative to the recent emphases on rational choice, the rise of probabilistic reasoning, and risk. One that fixes its attention on the radical uncertainties that modern technology produces, rather than the risks that it can help to redress. And for economists, a return to this earlier moment in the history of discipline might provide a gentle reminder that some aspects of the economic world can only be addressed by literary methodologies. According to Frank Knight, the relentless novelties of experience, for better and for worse, left us with no other choice.
Slide.
be the case that despite the existence, and he understood it in telling exactly what radical uncertainty was, he said that he defines it early on, not using it exactly. Might be the case that in some way, despite this, what we now call some sort of process of Bayesian learning, might we be able to at least gain some sort of local optimum through Bayesian learning, even though radical uncertainty exists. And he considers this and says, well, there are actually two conditions which must apply in order to even to think about getting to a local optimum rather than necessarily a global optimum. He's not really dismisses that hand in hand. So for convergence to a local equilibrium in the face of uncertainty, we have to have two conditions to be satisfied. Well, first of all, if we adopt a trial strategy, we must have some way of deeming whether it is a success or failure ex post. We must be able to recognize it. And the position achieved must be comparable with results of other potential actions. And he said, well, you know, if this is the case, yes, then through some sort of Bayesian learning, to use a phrase, then we might get to what we want. But they say under uncertainty, it's highly unlikely that these conditions will be met, simply because the external environment of the firm is not static, but it's changing. And it's changing sufficiently rapidly that it's actually very difficult to carry out systematic learning, which will bring the system to a local optimum. And some formalization of mathematical models of evolution in the late 1990s obtained similar types of results, addressing slightly different problems. So the comparability of resulting situations is destroyed by the fact that the environment in which economic agents operate, especially that of companies, tends to be changing extremely rapidly. So systematic learning in the face of uncertainty may be very difficult. So what are the implications? And this is Alshut's implication, this is what I want to expand on. If we face a world of radical uncertainty, we need at least one different null model of agent behavior to replace that of rational choice. We need to pull the rational choice model to one side as a basis for our analysis and replace it with at least one different model. The very fundamentals of science, in my view, need to be changed. And by null, I simply mean the principles underlying the basic model of behavior. So these obviously can be adapted and extended if necessary. So the same way we have the fully rational model, that can be adapted to include imperfect information. So the null model is the basic statement of the principles of behavior, which can always then be built on and adapted. So we need to change the null model. So Alshut argues, and the bulk of his paper is devoted to this, that uncertainty provides an excellent reason for imitation of success. Because if you look in your local neighborhood, you have to adopt a strategy, you see who's doing well, and say, I'll try that. So simply, the imitation from different disciplines has used different words. You may call it copying, you may call it social learning, but in fact the agents are essentially imitating, copying apparent success. The key point, obviously, which is that if the environment is changing rapidly, a strategy which is successful now, which you copy, may continue to be successful for an unpredictable period of time, and they will cease to be successful. It may fall to second best, it may fall to end best in an evolutionary situation. And so we simply look around and copy. The implication of the null model here is that we pay no attention to the necessarily the attributes of the alternatives. We just say, is it working? And we copy it if that's the case. I think a remarkable confirmation, I'm not going to go into the details here, I strongly recommend this paper by Rendell and
neighborhood was absolutely hands down at the very confidence of our. So, and we do have within economics, we're all aware of the fact, we already have models of imitation. We have learning models, we all know about these. But the thing is, in economics, these are seen as the special case. We have the model of rational behavior, and we know that in some circumstances, we can reach into our toolbox and pull out a learning model to imitate, if we think these are particular circumstances. So a key question then becomes, empirically, what does the world look like? Does it look more like the world of radical uncertainty, or does it look more like the world of rationality? Because we want to get which tool we pull out first is going to be important depending on what the world looks like. I mean, just to mention that there are mathematical models for cultural evolution. I give a number of references in the paper that's available on the web that I wrote, in which agents are unusual in the sense that they are indifferent, so they're extreme from rational behavior, when we select on the basis of the attributes of the alternatives. In the cultural evolution models, you are neutral, you are indifferent to the attributes. They perform very well on many empirical data sets. But just as an aside, many empirical outcomes, socioeconomic outcomes in the world, are typically highly non-Gaussian, which is a point which these models find very easy to accommodate, and very easy to be congruent with the data. The non-Gaussian nature of many, many outcomes, I can kind of give examples in the paper, on the web, is difficult for rational theory to accommodate. Well, here's some empirical evidence. What do real-life markets exhibit? Well, certainly from a consumer perspective, increasingly we see a dramatic increase in the number of alternative choices which are available, many of whose attributes differ in numerous minor ways which are difficult to comprehend. Now, looking around this audience at its age, I'd like you all to think about how you selected your smartphone, whether you did it by rational choice, or whether you asked a younger person whether it worked. So that's just one example of copying as an efficient strategy. There's a phrase, decision quickset, which I rather like, because the attributes are very difficult to rather gather. Now, Eric, when he was at McKinsey, so he may be wrong by a factor of 10 here, estimated on any single day in New York alone, consumers face a choice of 10 billion, it is wrong by 10, it's still a billion, alternatives at the stock keeping unit at the SKU level. And this is a level at which retailers restock. So it's not just a brand, it's below the brand. It's a six pack or it's whatever, or the bottle or whatever. In 10 billion alternatives in a single day, there's a massive amount of choice we can't conceivably process this. So I've published, it's a heuristic classifier. How might we decide whereabouts in the world we are? I published this paper with a couple of anthropologists who were originally trained as physicists. And it's a heuristic, it's not trying to answer all the questions. So we're sort of saying on one axis here, with this huge red dot, going up and down, we're saying, well, attributes are easy to distinguish, so the cost of gathering and processing information about the attributes of the alternatives is quite low. We can get this information. And as we move down, it becomes particularly hard. Now, it's a two-dimensional chart, so an important point, I think, is if we move down, one way in which attributes might be hard to distinguish is with alternatives which have strong implications for the future. So if we're choosing a pension scheme now, we can actually look at the rates of return, easy. When we're thinking, how are they going to perform in 10 years' time, a very hard problem, very hard to distinguish. Moving from on the horizontal axis is the degree to which agents are selecting independently, or the degree to which I put here copying or imitating or carrying out social learning. Now it seems to me that rational economic theory is in the top left-hand quadrant. There's a place for it in this chart. It's there. If attributes decisions, complex decisions, when we're thinking about moving beyond copying. So decisions which might be hard to reverse. And I'm putting a phrase there for yours, those of you who may be nostalgic for the economic growth theory of the 60s and 70s, Potty Clay, which is a very neat phrase, which says before you actually install a piece of capital, if you make a decision, it's potty. You can do an awful lot with the same amount of cash. But once you've built the machine, once you've invested in the technology, then it's clay. It's very hard to change. So hard to reverse. Decisions which are hard to reverse and which have implications well into the future belong to the Southwest quadrant. And I think it's the bottom, yes, Southwest, that's right, bottom left-hand side, yes. I think it's here that we need to introduce further concepts to overlay any models of cultural evolutionary-based models that we'll be using on the right-hand side of the chart to characterize a non-appropriate, non-model of behavior in worlds which look like that. Because one of the problems will be, in a world like this, it may be that it's very hard to find things to copy. So, for example, at the moment, the biggest construction project in Western Europe is something called Crossrail, which involves digging through the entire, traversing central London in entirely new tunnels to build an entirely new railway. It's actually being built. There's a huge argument about it before it went ahead. Well, where could we copy that from? You know, it's very hard to look around the world and find examples of that. But it went ahead. And this is where David Tuck and his team are making major contributions. So it's the face of uncertainty here, where it may be imitation in many circumstances, but it's a good strategy you face with uncertainty and see what works, or you choose something that somebody whose judgment you trust has already chosen. But in a world like this, we should be imitation on a feasible strategy. How can we make any decision at all rather than be completely paralyzed into inaction? And what we're doing there is, in a sense, creating a narrative, creating a story which enables us to act, thinking of the basic emotions of anxiety and excitement, like fear and greed. We create stories for ourselves to actually say, well, it would give me the confidence to actually make decisions in a world where I can't use, or it's very hard to use, a strategy of copying from what other people have done, because there are no real meaningful comparisons. And so this will be in a world where decisions are hard to reverse, which have implications what way into the future. And of course, this is the sort of thing that the fact that people do cost of acquiring information, or the great difficulty of distinguishing between plethora of consumer products, which itself is an uncertain situation, or whether it's on major decisions, which are hard to reverse and which go into the future, we need a selection of null models of agent behavior. So the implication of radical uncertainty is that we need different null models of agent behavior in order to make scientific advances. Rational theory has its place, and it has its place in that top left-hand quadrant of the world where we can actually relatively easily discover differences, attributes, and where we're selecting on an independent basis. If the world empirically looks at something else, we need fundamentally different null models of behavior. Thanks very much.
Happened to us where somebody says, nobody can see it coming. I can remember was happening, and in fact had enough rationality to bet that speculating against the pound could win. Just as Bill has shown also in venture capital and private equity. So it's not the case that all of our information about markets is evenly distributed. In fact, one of my concerns is that the great economics departments may not be, in fact, in institutions like universities. They may, in fact, be living in hedge funds, whether it's Renaissance or someplace in Silicon Valley. So you have to imagine, in some sense, the knowledge, what for me might be radically uncertain, may for this man in the audience, in fact, be something that he understands and just privately doesn't share. Next big problem is that what we really have is an almost insatiable appetite of very brittle institutions for low variance processes. Right? Many people want to clip coupons, receive an annuity, or find some process which they can lever so to produce a steady stream of returns. And in order to do that, if you think about taking an electric guitar and an amplifier, you want to turn your amplifier all the way up. That guitar has to be incredibly quiet and have very little vibration in the room. And so it's hard to find a room which is quiet enough to have that as a safe process. So the search for freakish processes of tiny variance is really driven by our desire to grow big, large institutions, even though there's nothing in nature that says this is necessarily going to be a stable process. So therefore, I'm going to claim that radical uncertainty is actually just regular uncertainty. But it is as viewed by the radically certain. So the appearance of the radically certain and their power and prestige is very mysterious. How did the radically certain get to be among us? How do they have so much ability to keep coming back cycle after cycle, whether they knew what they were doing or didn't know what they were doing? Various members of this class are always with us. And they usually have some ability to access levers of power to correct for mistakes that the rest of us do not. So the existence and emergence of a class of radically certain human beings who are usually well-dressed, well-spoken, well-credentialed, but who fundamentally need to create concepts like the great moderation, if you recall that idea, when we banished volatility during the period before 2008, is really, this is the more important and more innovative fact, which is that this class has somehow ascended. So the real issue and problem for us is radical certainty and its institutionalization rather than the reverse. So that's going to be the cut I want to take on this. Let's see where it goes. So I'd like to have a comparison. This conference seems to be about economic and academic elite. If the heterodox end of that, trying to harness innovation to provide stable growth. So stable growth is, in some sense, a reworking of the concept of innovation. And the idea is that if somehow we can get government policy, the correct data sets, the right people, we can build up the knowledge workers, we can create good jobs and stable sectors, we have to harness these innovators in order to provide the needs of the country. I think that's not necessarily wrong, but I do think that it is, in some sense, the reverse of another gathering. A different meaning has technical elites trying to harness stability to support radical innovation and creativity. And in some sense, this tension of looking at growth versus innovation, this is, of course, the city plan of a temporary city of perhaps 60,000 people. I think it's the fourth largest city when it's operating in the valley. The scene from space, and you see how regular, in fact, its city plan is. But what that regularity does is to facilitate something which is, which reminds us of how mind-blowing and how violent and how creative the human spirit can be. And of course, this is what Elon Musk was just using to complain about the HBO series Silicon Valley, saying that to understand the engine of creativity, you have to fundamentally attend its rituals and understand the society as it sees itself. So what can we predict about the unknown unknowns in the private goods of tomorrow? So the reason I say private goods is that one of my great fears about radical uncertainty is that almost everything that we think of as a private good, let's say this glass, is going to be equivalent to a small file, right? We can scan this for the plan of the glass, and we can distribute that, and a small file will have the attributes of being inexhaustible and excludable, therefore public good, and therefore price and value may gap. And we may have a situation in which a lot of the economy starts to look like what we previously considered an edge case. But the quantities that will be sold will be measured in quantity variables. I don't know what those things are. It may be in clicks, it may be in liters, it may be in hours. But I do know something about what is likely to be the units in which those things will be traded. I also know that they will be approximately linearly priced in currencies per unit quantity. So the prices and quantities, P and Q, will form systems of conjugate variables. So if you have any physics background, it's sort of vaguely humorous to note that P and Q are the same symbols we use for position and momentum. And in fact, this has to do with the fact that nature, far from being infinitely inventive at her deepest levels, tends to repeat the same games over and over again, even in widely separated strata. And so one of the hopes is that, in fact, it's very difficult to introduce fundamentally new games to nature, because, in fact, what happens is that we tend to port old games into new locations, what usually provides innovation. We also believe that they will probably be birthed by things akin to known structures, so that the economics and business of creating these new things that we supposedly cannot even conceive of, in fact, is going to bear some homology to our current structures. I don't know what the app of tomorrow will be, but I know that people will probably ask if there's a Series A, who's leading the round. So let's talk about radical uncertainty in the program that Pina Milani and I were undertaking as grantees of INET. So the first problem is that I'm coming at it from mathematics and physics, and people always imagine, oh, you're one of those people who are confused that you think that this is all like physics and you don't really get it. But no, in fact, exactly right. Economics is simply a branch of primate biology. And I don't think you should really be questioning that. We're primates, this is how we conduct ourselves. We find ourselves a system of evolutionary pressures. May the best men and women win. That's what we're up to, and that's what we're using markets to do. So human, after all, is probably a pretty good title for the conference. Markets, however, are getting slighted in this, because what's happening, you see, is that in the backlash against physics, against mathematics, and really against the abuse of power using physics and mathematics, our greatest achievements are coming under some kind of suspicion. What markets are really a mathematical wrapper around this unbounded biology. It uniformizes biology. And it gives our markets and our goods and our interactions the characteristics of being an as-if physical system. So, yes, it's true that you are not a proton. It's true that an inclined plane and a weight on a spring are not good models for the economy. But it is not true, therefore, that it is surprising. It's not true, really, that mathematics and physics intuition are being foisted upon economics. The markets itself gives economics those characteristics and uniformizes it. And really, a rare opportunity is present in economics, which I'll talk about, I think, in the next slide, to combine these two. So we should ask how nature herself handles so-called radical uncertainty. And if we are in a situation in which we have both characteristics of physics and biology present, we should look to nature and see how she's done it, having nothing to do with markets, but in terms of our evolution and our understanding of physics. So let's talk about the proper place, as we see it in our research, for economics and the pantheon of ideas, and then we'll try to see whether there's some takeaways from that perspective. So first of all, here are the two candidates that get blamed. You're making economics look too much like physics. No, you're making it look too much like biology. Their primary clients are neoclassical economics, in the physics case particularly, find other planets, almost certainly selection will be active there, even if life isn't based around RNA or DNA. Likewise, one of the great takeaways of 20th century physics is that all of our physical theories turn out to be based on geometry and symmetry. And it's remarkable the extent to which, after 1975, in the work of hedge fund manager Jim Simons, along with Cian Yang, that what we have is a completely geometrical picture of physics, in which no corner of physics is now non-geometric. So what happens in our case is we believe that geometric dynamics and selection are the parents, the abstract, some of you write code, these are sort of the abstract classes. And we have a multiple inheritance pattern where geometric marginalism should be the field which takes economics to be fundamentally about primate behavior, wrapped in a vehicle which is fundamentally an as-if physical system, right? And so therefore, you should not have this war between whether neoclassical or behavioral economics is the right paradigm. You should be looking at an inclusive model with the right inheritance properties. Let's assume that that's right. Therefore, there should be lessons in radical uncertainty from both parent subjects, from geometric dynamics, and also from selection. So let's do selection first, since it's being given pride of place in this topic. So first of all, let's look at mammalian adaptive capacity. Of course, as mammals, we are all, in some sense, jawed fish. And in jawed fish, we saw the emergence of an adaptive immune system. An immune system that does not know what is coming next. It is facing unknown unknowns. But it doesn't run and hide mumbling something about Frank Knight under its chair, right? What it does is it prepares a generic response capable of innovation, mutation, acts of brilliance and grace, even if it is not a thinking system. All right, so fundamentally, it has a very small number of components, in some sense, which are able to mount an incredibly calculated as-if response, an as-if calculated response. We are also at the absolute extreme of case selection relative to our selection. That is, we care and love our children much more than any other animal cares and loves its children. June was just talking about the 12 years it takes before your brain begins to set. Right? And of course, that's approximately the 12 years takes for humans to get to sexual maturity, which is an incredible risk for any animal to take, right? But we invest and we adapt based upon the idea that we know we are going to find changing circumstances and we are going to be based around software rather than hardware. So of course, human infants have to be pushed out very, very early because we pose a threat to our mothers with our giant brain cases, right? We have the largest brain to body ratio. Here you see us in the brain-body diagram, the extreme point here in modern man. We are all about software adaptation and improvisation. That's what we do. And in some sense, it's weird to think about radical uncertainty as from the perspective of the species, which is probably best able to handle it because of our cognitive capacity and our brains aren't purposed at birth. Lastly, we also have reserve requirements. So if you can't handle radical uncertainty, you can always put more away for a rainy day and try to stay away from what other people might consider the efficient frontier. If you think about the cheetah, which has probably the highest percentage of kills of any land predator, you ask, well, why are cheetahs not more common? It's a ferocious animal that has, I don't know, 80% kill rates, or something like that. And the answer is that if a cheetah screws up a couple of times, it's got a starvation problem, right? Because it's moving incredibly quickly, it's burning a lot of energy, and it can take very little in terms of fat reserves before it degrades its own ability. So we have a situation in which we have a universal response to radical uncertainty, which is to build up reserves and to stay away from the siren call of overly efficient strategies which are in fact self-extinguishing. So we need to move economics away from risk management towards the adaptive management of uncertainty, or ANU. If we had ANU managers rather than risk managers, we would be talking, in fact, about agents as being machines that take complicated, uncertain situations and put them into as-if risk paradigms through some sort of Bayesian competition to see who's good at it, who's not so good, which may explain some of the variations you see in your charts. What, if anything, do we get from physics? Well, here, we have a very interesting different set of paradigms. Physics, first of all, has an area that has not, so far as I'm aware, been very effectively mined, which is renormalization theory. It's hard to understand what they're talking about. But the key issue in renormalization theory is that there are errors and flaws in all of our theories. We tell lies. When we tell lies, we have to remember what strata we're in, what lies have been told. We may not know what lies have been told, but we can ask the question, what observables or questions are insensitive to the lies we've told? Which of them, if we break things into fast variables, which we don't have any idea about, even if they were deterministic, we're just not smart enough to compute them, or slow variables, which we think we can handle. The question is, what observables or questions live in the strata with the lies that are robust to the lies we've told? The big fear in economics is that there are almost no interesting observables relative to the stratification when we're thinking about macro. And I think that this drives a lot of the fear that we think we can predict almost nothing with very high efficacy. And so we should look to physics and see how they've settled the problem. And remember that between 1928 and 1947, they screwed up with the mass of the electron by not understanding this and missed out on about 20 years of results from quantum molecular dynamics. So we partition the strata and the strata observables that are robust and fragile to the lies at that level, and restrict to the observables that are robust to fast variables. What about the quantum? So the last two conferences I've attended at INET, George has talked to us about what we're doing wrong. And I think we need to take it seriously at an analytic level, and not just because of its prowess in the markets. I think that one thing is that we need to promote uncertainty from a bug to a feature. So when physics stopped in terms of its influence in modern economics, it tended to sort of have stopped before we learned how to propagate uncertainty and to fundamentally embrace uncertainty and to change variables so that the wave functions that may explain the possible position of a particle, in fact, are propagated with, let's say, certainty under Schrodinger equation, right? So by changing variables, we fundamentally embrace the uncertainty and we get rid of George's determinism critique if we have a tight enough system that allows us to propagate uncertainty. We may fail at it, but we'd do much better looking for the physical, as a physical groundwork within economics that might allow us to do that than simply complaining about the fact that uncertainty spoils everything. The other critique George has made is that gravity and geometric field is handled by gravity and geometric fields. He complains about the simplicity of the axioms of economics and has a critique that they are akin to the Euclidean axioms, which are too simple. But of course, what happened in particle theory and in gravitation. So in gravitation, it happened around 1913-1915 from earlier work of Riemann, and in particle theory, it really started to bubble up in the 1950s with the Aronoff-Bohm effect and the work of Simons and Yang, and built on the work of the Alsatian Charles Ehrenschlag. And in those cases, we promoted path dependence, which we had the same negative view of as economics has traditionally had a negative view of path dependence. We realize it is absolutely not a bug. It is a feature, and it is in fact the central centerpiece of all of modern physics. Right. So the rule in physics and in math is you always begin with first a naive hope, the recognition that your childhood dreams are dashed and the hope is not realized. You then construct an object that measures the failure of your naive hope, and fourth, you promote that object to the centerpiece of your new theory, and it turns out to be far more elegant than anything you had to begin with, right? So that, I'd like to have us consider doing that in economics. So hopefully I haven't completely screwed up the assignment trying to get into human, after all, innovation and radical uncertainty. Here are the conclusions and recommendations. First of all, the economics of innovation and the innovation of economics are inseparable. And this comes out of conversations with Bill Janeway and Pia Milani, Peter Thiel. I believe that fundamentally constructing, it would appear almost anything. So what we need is a very small, extensible toolkit, not the sort of cacophony of heterodox different ideas, but a tiny toolkit which is capable of almost infinite variety. When dealing with markets, we have to inherit from physics the idea of renormalization, the quantum and gauge theory for managing uncertainty properly. We should not come to markets assuming that they will behave naively. We should figure out what our naive hopes are and what the failure is of those hopes, and we should measure that and make that the centerpiece of our theory. And lastly, I want to talk about an idea of Pia's, which is, when she was talking about, why are we peer reviewing dangerous ideas when we know that peer review is exactly the wrong tool? Once upon a time, the double helix was submitted to Nature, but it wasn't peer reviewed because it couldn't be peer reviewed. The danger was too great. So one of Pia's ideas is that we should come up with an index of disruption. So in talking about that, we've talked about the idea that maybe we should fund any project that experts seek to privately derail, but will not publicly go short, because maybe that's the signature of a great and dangerous and disruptive idea. Anyway, it's been great fun addressing you, and thank you for your time.
First, I should point out that originally I was a biochemist who taught biometrics at the University of Pennsylvania. Then I was an actuary for the U.S. Life Insurance Company before I came to economics. So I know a lot about what I'm going to talk about. And the question is very simple. Time is a device that prevents everything from happening at once. People make decisions today and they know what payoffs will be in the future. What do they know about the future? First question you have to answer is, do you believe there is information that exists today which you can somehow find if you're smart enough that will tell you about the future or not? Now, Knight said there was information that exists today, but that we weren't capable of getting it. We were known by somebody, maybe his God up there or somebody, but it's already predetermined.
future is not evenly distributed, as has been remarked upon many times. And so, in part, this is a competitive game about who's got enough scratch to play their hunches and how well those hunches work out relative to some trade expression which instantiates that view of the future. So I think you have to say that there are some people who have shown track records that strongly suggest that this is not completely random. And one of the things I keep hoping when I put up a list of innovations, that somebody will create a data set, maybe some enterprising young person, which takes different innovations from different fields, abstracts them anonymously, and allows us to get something from a large N when normally each field has only a small N to work with great other things.
I'll just touch on briefly from a historical perspective, which I guess is to say that the unknowability of the future looks very different in very different periods. To me, that's one of the central insights when you get into this post-war period. On the one hand, economics is taking one track related to largely to decision theory. And then you have this list of other people following up on the fundamental Knightian insult, the idea that in contemporary societies you have an ever-accelerating pace of change which only itself accelerates the unknowability of the future. And the incredibly complicated problem of trying to engage in predictive acts of what society is going to look like in 10 or 20 years when you're living in the midst of very rapid technological transformations. Whereas in primitive societies, the knowability of the future, although in some ways was much less, in other ways was much greater.
Yes, we are people trying to create the future, but other agents are doing that at the same time. And I think it's that interplay which makes it inherently unknowable. Because we know from biology that it's not necessarily the case, if you like, that the one who's creating with superior attributes is the one who's going to succeed. I mean, chance is contingent by a great part. So it's this whole point of the interaction with the changing environments, the fact that other agents are trying to create a future, which indicates it in some aspects, of decision making, inherently unknowable.
Next question.
Well, I, first of all, I have to thank Eric once again, because I hadn't appreciated that when I conceptualized what I learned as a venture capitalist about the only available retrospective hedge against what you could not know was going to whack you, which I call cash and control, was actually the development of an adaptive immune system at the level, the micro level of venture capital investing, but which also scales to China holding $3 trillion in reserves and Apple holding $150 billion of excess cash. These are exercises of self-insurance, which are, in fact, in economics, in financial economics, the system of adaptive immune response to unknowable events. But second, I do think that this notion of, this is where I think the reflexivity debate got a little off, didn't quite capture the full extent to which it is the acting on expectations which are not fulfilled, which changes the fundamentals on the basis of which new expectations are being formed competitively, that leads to this kind of dynamic, what you call the as-if physical, which in fact is deeply biological, is deeply trial and error, natural selection. And I know that Marshall always, always chose metaphor from biology, not from physics, at the time when, coming after the Marshallist economists, Balras and Menger and Jevons, were pulling metaphors from physics. And in a sense, Marshall, you know, won the battle and lost the war. And then finally, I'd like to ask those who might. I found a deep resonance in Keynes's uncertainty with Hume's uncertainty. This is for the philosopher. So each of them actually use the same word, although Keynes gives Hume no credit. They each talk about the convention. Keynes is very explicit. The reason that it is possible for society to have continuity and for markets to have continuity is that we accept, we act on the convention that things will stay the same until we have sufficient evidence that they won't, until 2008 happens. And Hume said virtually exactly the same thing. Has that been explored as
So you mentioned Keynes. I mean, the other figure I'd mentioned in relation to Hume that's really interesting, and Bruce obviously knows a lot about this, but is Hayek. And it's striking in the Constitution of Liberty, right, Hayek says that Hume is his constant sage and guide. And why is Hume his constant sage and guide? It's for precisely this reason. It's because Hayek says in the presumption of ignorance, we can derive two fundamental insights. On the one hand, it's a justification for deference to social conventions, because we recognize that we might not fully understand why social conventions exist. We recognize our own ignorance, and so unless there's a good reason to overturn them, we should defer to them. And at the same time, deference to the outcomes of markets as well, ways of structuring our individual ignorance within systems that can yield results that reflect the knowledge of lots of different individuals. And so for Hayek, it's precisely that Humean mode of analysis that allows him to connect appreciation for traditional orders of society and the marketplace, a very difficult problem for a lot of people of conservative sensibilities who are oriented towards the free market, which seems in many ways to undermine social conventions.
I have a very hard time understanding statements of the sort that one needs to use a literary analysis instead of probabilities, as if these two things were exclusive. But in this part, I don't know what you mean by literary analysis, but I think what you mean is what Lawson calls the process of abduction, which is you look at something that happened in the past, and then you try to tell the story of what must have happened. But here's the thing, this story doesn't write itself. You need to choose the story, and you choose the story amongst alternatives, and you choose it by looking at the evidence as it's presented to you, and increasing or decreasing the degree of confidence or belief or whatever you want to call it about that story. Well, when you think about this a little harder, then this degree of belief quickly becomes a probability, because if it's not, then you run into problems. For example, if you have two mutually exclusive stories, evidence is presented that makes one go up and must make the other one go down. And then the way to update your beliefs, if you then think a bit harder on that, quickly arises to what Bayesian inference is. And that's looking at the past. And then when you look at the future, it looks exactly the same way. You establish the stories, you assign degrees of beliefs, and you update your beliefs as evidence gets out. You can copy as a strategy to assign stories, but it's exactly what you're doing. And the final comment is this has nothing whatsoever to do with erudicity. Erudicity is only necessary if you want to estimate some parameter. But Bayesian inference and the type of logic that I'm describing means that you don't need to estimate anything. A very good friend of Bill Jamer's in Cambridge, Chris Rogers, has a t-shirt where he says, estimate nothing as the motto of Bayesian inference.
Narratives come forward at a point in time and compete with each other. And there are now ways of measuring this. And which one gets to dominance at a point in time is not necessarily connected in any way to the evidence to the objective correctness or otherwise. So in the period 2004 to mid-2007, one particular narrative emerged that the problems of recessions have been solved forever. That was a dominant narrative. It completely disconnected from evidence. And that was a question of agents imitating each other. Or we might think in response to Bill's previous question, I mean social convention, using social convention is a special case of social learning, of imitation, a range of ways to do that. But yeah, but narrative, the choice of narrative needn't be based on evidence at all.
Yeah, I'll just add that I certainly didn't mean that it was an either-or proposition. The main point that I was making there is that there's certain kinds of questions that you can ask about uncertainty, questions which are, in a sense, the central questions that ask knights. The knight asks risk, uncertainty, and profit that just simply don't follow that line of analysis. Questions about what are the social implications of uncertainty for polities and so on, that allow us to think about this problem as more than a problem of decision theory, but rather a problem that's fundamental to thinking about how we order our political, philosophical lives, right? So to that end, it's not coincidental, and David Lee has a nice paper talking about this, they have John Rawls' heavily annotated copy of Knight's Ethics of Competition, so you can see right there a kind of dialogue happening between political philosophy and economics that's made possible in part by Knight's willingness to engage in linear analysis that asks fundamentally different questions than the kind that motivate your line of inquiry there. And I'm certainly not saying that they should supplant those lines of inquiry, but rather that there's something productive about economists being willing to take that. The Knightian approach that we in subsequent years saw was also taken.
Yes?
Hi. You've mentioned the reluctance of the economics profession to think about uncertainty because of this issue that we can't model it. And now we have new modeling approaches that seem really interesting, drawing from complexity and evolutionary approaches. My question is, can we economists still feel like we have something meaningful to say about things, even if we can't model them? I'm thinking about the precautionary principle, maybe one example, or in finance, even if we can't predict the probability that an institution might fail, or we may not be able to figure out how much regulatory capital we may have, we can still think about a robust financial system, robust to the failure of any single loan, even if we can't predict where it's going to fail. Is that a meaningful thing to ask, or what are your thoughts?
Well, yes, I'm just making the point that in different types of situation where the level of uncertainty is different, the basic model of analysis we should be choosing should be a different one. And in response to Derek's point, I said we just need a few basic models we have to construct. That was the whole point that I was making. It doesn't say it's wrong to look at the design of the system. But I think ultimately my feeling is that things are an empirical question. Which is the appropriate non-model to select will depend upon whether it's empirically relevant. And we must be able to test our models. And if necessary to say it is not relevant in this particular context, or it is, at least it's not rejected by the data. So ultimately we have to be empiricists, I think, much more so than economists in general have been willing to be.
I think it's really important and very uncomfortable to think about the idea that when there's proof that somebody knows what's going on, if that person won't talk, it tells you that you have an excellent problem that bears a lot of analysis. I think that in mathematics and physics, we keep problems open, whereas economics tends to assume something that closes the problem. So we've been dealing with the situation with changing preferences, where if you assume the preferences don't change, you have ordinal welfare comparison, but of course, preferences do change. So economics has a bad habit, which is to fundamentally seal the field against this tradition of keeping open problems open. And the presence of a Jim Simons in the market, which is supposedly not ergodic, not stationary, every bad thing it can be, yet this guy tends to make money year in and year out. So we should view that as a closed economics department on Long Island. And we should say, well, if the rest of our economics departments aren't up to the same task, that's just reason to double our efforts. It's certainly not reason to give up on these things. As for what culture we should adopt while we're trying to see whether anyone can pull the sword out of the stone, it's important to reward brilliant attempts and failures to keep the field alive and incremental progress, and to know when it's time to condense and to have many different avenues coalesce into one, and when it's time to open things up. And I think that it's really important to recognize the unbelievable importance of interference competition in academics as a system of selective pressures. And if we could just figure out how to use the power of INET to do something about interference competition, I think you might see unbelievable boosts in our predictive power.
I'm going to add a comment. There's Hayek has been invoked, and there's someone who's working, I'd say, roughly within a Hayekian tradition, perhaps also a public choice tradition, called Mark Pennington. And he wrote about the necessity of robust political economy, Hayekian in the sense that looking at not just economics, but a host of social, cultural, political, juridical institutions, and asking what sorts of institutions are going to be robust against two of the major problems in trying to organize societies, one of them being that people will sometimes behave opportunistically, and secondly, that we often don't have full knowledge. So we are seeking institutions that will help coordinate human action in an environment in which we want to forestall opportunistic behavior and not require policymakers to have full information in order to achieve certain results. So I just mentioned, I didn't know where that person went, but Mark Pennington's book, Robust Political Economy, at least attempts to address some of the broad issues that you raised. Yes.
One theme that has been, that all of you have taken up in various forms of politics.
So,
okay, the theme is should one innovate or should one imitate? And cultural evolution has a lot to say about that. In times that don't change very quickly, it's much better to imitate. If the environment changes a lot, then it's a good idea to innovate. And now, if you combine this with niche construction, which has not been mentioned here, that we affect our environment, if we start innovating, lots of people start innovating, that changes our environment, that makes it more desirable to innovate. And that, however, evokes psychological reactions. Those psychological reactions are based on our evolutionary past. Whether we see things as a threat or whether we see them as an opportunity depends on our past experiences. If, however, the pace of innovation is much quicker than what we have done in the past, we're much more likely to see the innovation as a threat and thereby engender more crises. Do you have anything to say about this aspect of radical uncertainty?
You have negative 10 seconds to respond.
Well, I could speak to you later about it. Yes, I'm not quite sure I agree. If we have a situation where things are changing very rapidly, one reasonable strategy might very well be in your local neighborhood if somebody is prospering. I mean, that might not last for long. It all depends on the relative cost of working out your own strategy, doesn't it? This is where understanding crises is still very, very useful. If it's going to be really hard to think of an alternative, but somebody next door is doing very well, and the climate's changing very rapidly, and the next door farmer's got a high crop yield, or plant what he does, you know, that might be a good strategy. So I'm not sure that it's always the case. You've got to weigh the relative cost and benefits.
Let's thank our panelists, please.
Ideological or material concerns. So, of course, as the debate among nice contemporaries who are concerned with these kinds of problems demonstrated, these dispositional tolerances were very complex in practice. Right? So if you take the examples of Hayek and Keynes, both worry deeply about problems of uncertainty, but they reserve their concerns for their primary concerns for uncertainties of a very different kind. So Hayek's emphasis on the ignorance of the individual in essays like Economics and Knowledge, or many of the commonalities with nice discussions of uncertainty, as Bruce Caldwell had in his provocative and an essay that I largely agree with. In the Journal of Economic Methodology, argues that we can see some commonalities between Hayek and Soros, despite what seem to be very striking differences. Social and philosophical context that more technical discussions of the distinction too often askew. So in the following remarks, what I'm going to try to do is pull out five ideas from Knight that maybe we can think with a little bit as we parse through contemporary debates about uncertainty. First, Knight's argument in that book that uncertainty is everywhere, that it's a fundamental and inextricable aspect of the human condition. Second, that our response to uncertainty is deeply conflicted. Third, that it plays a foundational role in the development of political ideologies, that we need to think about uncertainty when we think about problems of politics. Fourth, that's an important variable when we try to understand historical changes in economic and political views. And fifth, these aspects of uncertainty can only be understood through literary or fully understood when we are willing to adopt literary methodologies that esteem the temptation to quantify. So all this will suggest that Knight's economics of radical uncertainty would look quite different from those that have predominated in recent years, and that some of the problems that he emphasizes might help both historians and economists to reframe their approach to the problem in productive ways. Okay, so first, Knight's observation that uncertainty was everywhere. I just want to pull out the fact that Knight was very explicit about this. In his words, it's a world of change in which we live, and a world of uncertainty. We live only by knowing something about the future, while the problems of life or of conduct at least arise from the fact that we know so little. Right? So I think in David Tuckett's paper that he gave last year, which I think Paul will be building a little bit on, as I understand it, this is what we define as ontological uncertainty. The deep unknowability, the fundamental unknowability of the future. Knight begins with this stance of epistemic humility. For him, quantitative tools are merely bulwarks against a bafflingly complex, in his words, and fundamentally unknowable future. But for Hayek, it's crucial to understand that the uncertainties that bothered him most were precisely those uncertainties that are themselves created by the state, political uncertainty. And therefore, a primary concern becomes the creation of a stable network of laws that will allow business operators to proceed with a minimum of political indeterminacy. Keynes, in contrast, emphasized the crippling experience of uncertainty among everyday people, the capacity of business people to take advantage of these uncertainties to create massive inequalities of wealth, and argue that a host of interventions were necessary to help to limit them. It becomes a still more complex and fraught problem in Joseph Schumpeter's Capitalism, Socialism, and Democracy. So although he's highly sympathetic to Knight's idea of uncertainty, cited it multiple times, he worried that the existence of uncertainty was becoming increasingly marginalized by tendencies within capitalism itself. Right? So you get these wonderful ironic lines where he says, innovation itself is being reduced to routine. Technological progress is increasingly becoming the business of teams of trained specialists who turn out what is required and make it work in predictable ways. Market societies, that is, are squeezing out the very uncertainties that are their lifeblood. Since capitalist enterprises, he says, by their very achievements tend to automatize progress, we conclude that they tend to make themselves superfluous. Schumpeter's deep political pessimism emerged from his assessment of the changing structure of social and technological change. His high tolerance for certain kinds of uncertainty was accompanied by skepticism about the sustainability of an economic world. paper that was passed on it. So however distinct their different views, these economists, all like Knight, approached uncertainty as a problem of moral and political philosophy that could not be captured by economic analysis alone. Designing an economic order required foundational decisions about the kinds of uncertainties that can be mitigated and the degree to which it was desirable to do so. For this final generation of literary economists, the intellectual history of the
that a life with uncertainty eliminated, or perhaps even very greatly reduced.
appeal to us. So this is a characteristically bleak idea formulation, right? We're constantly attempting to constrain precisely that.